Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Moses. Thanks for preparing our minds to encounter God's word this morning. And now, friends, please join me with prayer as we ask God to prepare our hearts. Heavenly Father, as we turn our attention to your word today, we ask that you would equip us through your Holy Spirit to truly encounter you through it. May the words of my mouth, Lord, and the meditation of all of our hearts right now be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, friends, as many of you know from your own experiences, it is not easy to start over. Now think about your life. Think about a time when you have gone through a new beginning. Maybe the first day at a new school or on a new job. Perhaps the first practice with a new team. Maybe moving to a new city and figuring out a new rhythm for your life in that new place. Perhaps going off to college and leaving behind the familiar, leaving behind your family and your support systems. Maybe it's graduating from college and now facing that elusive enterprise known as adulting. Some of us are still getting used to that, perhaps. Or maybe it's finding a new path forward in the midst of challenge or hardship, crisis, or loss. Maybe it's the first day of retirement after a long and fulfilling career, and now you're not sure exactly what you're going to dedicate yourself to doing. Or maybe for some of us, it's looking forward to retirement, but then facing the economic and financial reality of having to go back to work when you weren't expecting to. New beginnings can be a part of life for all of us. Sometimes we approach these new beginnings with joy and excitement. Sometimes we approach them with dread and we drag our feet. But one thing is true, whether good or bad, whether easy or difficult, joyous or somber, new beginnings present an opportunity for us to encounter God and experience His faithfulness in a new kind of way. We see this truth at work in our passage this morning. As we move on to Ruth chapter 2, we pick up that story of Naomi and Ruth after they have suffered the loss of some of their loved ones and have realized that there's nothing left for them where they've been living, and they move from Ruth's homeland to Naomi's old hometown of Bethlehem. Their arrival in Bethlehem has created quite a stir as these two travel-weary women show up in this town with no resources, with no providers, and essentially no specific plan for the future. They're going to carve out a new life for themselves. And while Ruth is full of faith in God and optimism for the future, perhaps unfounded optimism from a human point of view, Naomi, on the other hand, has pretty much given up hope already. Yet, as they begin their new life in Bethlehem, we see that God meets them there. In fact, He's already there. He's been preparing the way for them. And as we survey chapter 2 this morning, we'll see that Ruth puts her faith into action. We'll see that God brings joy to her through the kindness of a new friend. And we'll see that Naomi begins to catch the very first glimmer of hope that she's had for a long time. So as we jump back into the story of Ruth this week, we see first Ruth putting her faith into action as God begins to open up new doors for her. The narrator of the book of Ruth gives us a sense right away of how God is setting things up for the next chapter of Ruth's story. We see this in chapter 2, verse 1, when a new character is introduced to the story. We read, "Now Naomi had a relative on her husband's side, a man of standing from the clan of Elimelech," that's the name of her deceased husband, "whose name was Boaz." Now, that's all that we're told about Boaz right now, but based on what we learn about Boaz in other places, we know that Boaz is one of the leading citizens of Bethlehem. He's kind of a big fish in a small pond, if you will, but he's still an important guy. He's probably about 50 or 60 years old at this time, and he has a reputation as a wise, an upright, and honorable man. He has a fair measure of wealth and influence, But yet he doesn't seem to have an elitist attitude, because we see him in this chapter interacting with his workers. He loves them, he cares for them, and they seem to have genuine respect for him, not just for the wealth that he has, but for the person that he is. And he's related to Elimelech's family. We don't know exactly what that family tie is, but we do know a little bit about some of Boaz's other family members. Now, I don't know about you, the genealogies in the Bible are not exactly the most popular passages. You don't see a lot of people citing their life verse coming from the first few chapters of Chronicles or some of those other passages. But you know me well enough to know that I'm a bit of a history nerd, and I love the Bible's genealogies. I love to sift through those names, and it's amazing for me when you start to see some of the same names resurface in different passages of Scripture. I'm there flipping through and cross-referencing different passages, and one of the things that we see when we look through these obscure details in Scripture is that there are hidden stories of the vibrant lives of people who lived thousands of years ago that we see hints of through the family connections in the Bible. And one of those is a man who is actually one of Boaz's ancestors. Boaz happened to be a direct descendant of a guy named Nahshon. Now, Nahshon is a name that we probably haven't heard much or come across in our study of Scripture, but you have heard of people that Nahshon was closely connected to. Nahshon lived during the time of Moses, and when the people of Israel were wandering through the wilderness, Nahshon was actually appointed to be the leader of the entire tribe of Judah. So it'd be kind of like having, you know, a governor of a state in our day. So Nahshon was a pretty big deal. He had a lot of power, a lot of influence, and he was obviously respected and seen as a good choice for that job. Now, one of the other things about Nahshon that is significant is the fact that Nahshon had a sister. His sister's name was Elisheba. You probably haven't heard of her, but you have heard of her husband. Elisheba was married to Aaron, the brother of Moses, the first high priest in Israel. So, I mean, I don't care who you are, but if one of your siblings is married to one of Moses' siblings, that's a pretty big deal. Those are some intense family connections, and that would have meant not only that Nahshon had Moses as part of his extended family, but it would have meant that Nahshon's kids and grandkids, even down to the time of Boaz, they were cousins of the high priests of Israel. They were related to some of the most important religious leaders of the day. So yes, Boaz is a pretty big deal. He is well connected. But he's the kind of guy that if you knew him, you wouldn't necessarily think he was a big deal, because he treats everyone well. He treats everyone the same. He shows kindness and respect to all people, and just kind of seems like one of the guys living with humility and kindness. So there's Boaz. That's a little bit of an introduction to him, and we'll talk more about him in a few minutes. So after introducing this new character, Boaz, to the story, the narrator then switches back to what's going on with Ruth and Naomi. Ruth and Naomi, they've just arrived from the land of Moab, and in God's perfect timing, the harvest is now ripe for the picking. And Ruth recognizes that this is a key opportunity for her to go out and get food. Now, back in chapter 1, we remember Ruth's stirring speech of faith. We just had a reminder of it in our service. The words that she said, "Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." Those are inspiring words, and when we hear them, we want to frame them and put them on the wall. But now, in the next chapter, it's time to put those inspiring words into action. It's time to put that faith into action. It's time to roll up the sleeves and get to work. And so we see verses 2 and 3. "And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, 'Let me go to the fields and pick up the leftover grain behind anyone in whose eyes I find favor.' Naomi said to her, 'Go ahead, my daughter.' So she went out, entered a field, and began to glean behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she was working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. So Ruth recognizes that the harvest season is here. It's a great time to put some food on the table. And according to Jewish law, those like Ruth and Naomi, who had no other means of providing for themselves, they were freely permitted to go to the fields and to follow along the workers who were harvesting the crop. And anything that was left behind, the poor people were allowed to pick up and take home as their own. In fact, landowners were actually commanded not to go back and pick up those leftovers. They had to leave them there for other people to come and pick up. The landowners were also commanded not to harvest the grain that was at the very edges of the field, but instead to leave that grain for other people, those who were poor or had financial need, who had no means of providing for themselves, for them to be able to come along and harvest that. Now, that was the law. Not everybody followed that law. And so Ruth knew that, okay, I'm allowed to do this theoretically, but she wasn't sure how it would actually work out. And this was one of the things in place. This was sort of part of their ancient welfare system, a built-in way in that culture to provide opportunity for anyone who is able to get up, to walk around, to pick up grain, to thresh that grain, to be able to at least carve out a meager existence for themselves. So Ruth knows about this, and she decides, hey, I better get to work. Naomi gives her permission to do that, and it's interesting here that Naomi doesn't go with her. Now, there might be different reasons for that, but as far as we could tell, Naomi is probably about 50 years old. She's able-bodied. She doesn't have any kind of health problems that we're made aware of. In fact, she's just completed a long journey back home from Moab. So we might expect for the two of them to go out together. When you think about it, two women working together would be safer, and they would be able to get a lot more done as a team. But for whatever reason, Naomi stays home. You know, maybe she's tired from the journey and needs more time to rest up and recover. But maybe there's more going on here. Considering what Naomi said at the end of chapter 1 about feeling hopeless, empty, and abandoned, I think it's pretty likely that Naomi's given up hope at this point. She doesn't really care what happens to her. She says, fine, go, do whatever you want. But her mindset right now is kind of still, woe is me, there's no future, why try, why bother? She's kind of stuck in her own hopelessness at this moment. But Ruth, on the other hand, goes off and springs into action. And she just so happens to arrive at Boaz's field. You can almost sense the narrator here giving us a little knowing wink about what's going on, because of course this is no coincidence at all. God is steering Ruth right where she needs to go. And here's another coincidence, that Boaz happens to arrive in verse 4. Just then, Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters. The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you, they answered. Boaz asked the overseer of his harvesters, who does that young woman belong to? The overseer replied, she is the Moabite who came back from Moab with Naomi. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters. She came into the field and has remained here from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. So it's Ruth's first day on the job, and she is hard at work. She is out in the field, it sounds like longer than this overseer is expecting, so she's rolling up her sleeves, she's getting her hands dirty, and she's already impressing the overseer with her work ethic. Now, even though she doesn't know it yet, God is already at work opening doors for her. And so, friends, as we consider this passage, as we consider what Ruth is doing, and as we consider Naomi's response, as we enter into this story, where do we find ourselves? In times when we are rocked and buffeted by the storms and the upheaval in our own lives, what's our response? Sometimes we may react a lot like Ruth. We don't exactly have a roadmap, but at least we have a sense of what the next step could be, so we step out in faith. We move into action, not really knowing what's going to happen, but still willing to give it our best shot and trust in God. This can happen a lot of different ways. We keep on filling out those job applications even when we've been doing that for a while and haven't gotten any calls yet. We keep reaching out to mend that broken relationship, even though a lot depends on what the other person will do and is outside of our control. We keep praying for that loved one who appears to be drifting farther and farther away from God. We go to that next doctor's appointment, even if we're not really convinced that they're going to find anything or it's going to do any good. We continue to offer loving correction to that child who just seems to be stuck in the wrong pattern. We keep moving forward, whatever the case may be, taking action in faith, even if we haven't seen any results yet. Sometimes that's our response, but at other times we may look more like Naomi. We know the story isn't likely to have a happy ending, so why even bother deluding ourselves with false hope? Why keep trying when it probably isn't going to do any good? Why not just cut our losses, lower our expectations, and resign ourselves to the fact that the best is already behind us? On a good day, I act more like Ruth. On a not-so-good day, my inner Naomi tends to kick in. But part of the good news that we see in this passage is that on our good days and on our bad days, God is still at work. The narrator knows this. He knows and he shows us what Ruth and Naomi can't see yet, that God is the one writing their story and bringing these people together for the sake of an even bigger story. And that's equally true for both Ruth and Naomi. They had different perceptions of the situation, and therefore they had different reactions to the situation. But God wasn't bound by their perceptions. He was still at work behind the scenes. And I think this can offer encouragement to us as well, that whatever our perceptions of our circumstances may be, whether we are holding on to hope or whether we have given up hope, God is not bound by that. He's not bound by what we think. He's not bound by our expectations. He is still at work. So whether you are taking action in faith or whether you find yourself standing still, stuck in despair, that doesn't change the fact that in all things, God is working for the good of those who love him and those who have been called according to his purpose. But while our perceptions and our actions don't limit God's action, they can affect our ability to see and celebrate what God is doing. Naomi remained at home, cut off from the opportunity to catch that first glimpse of what God was doing. Ruth, who made herself available to God and stepped into action, was quickly encouraged by the events that happened during her first day of foraging. As Ruth put her faith into action, God met her in the field, bringing her joy and encouragement through the kindness of Boaz. One of the things that we talk about a lot here at Warsaw EPC is bringing joy to our city. We see here in Ruth chapter 2 that Boaz was the kind of guy who went about life in such a way that brought joy to his city of Bethlehem. We just saw a little bit of that in the way he interacted with the workers, that he cared for them and they respected him. There was this relationship of flourishing and goodwill. And now we see this in several acts of kindness that Boaz displays toward Ruth. His first act of kindness to Ruth comes through an offer of protection and provision. Verses 8 through 10. So Boaz said to Ruth, "My daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with the women who work for me. Watch the field where the men are harvesting, and follow along after the women. I have told the men not to lay a hand on you, and whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled." At this, she bowed down with her face to the ground. She asked him, "Why have I found such favor in your eyes that you notice me, a foreigner?" So Boaz here has gone out of his way to notice the newcomer and welcome her. He recognizes that as a foreign-born minority woman living in the rural community of Bethlehem, her life is not likely to be easy. She's likely to bear the brunt of hostility, of gossip, of social exclusion, and she could perhaps even become the victim of violence if she happens to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Other landowners might not be as understanding or as protective, so Boaz urges her to stay there so that she'll be safe. He also invites her to use his worker's water supply, and he invites her to make herself feel at home there. Now, to Boaz, this probably seemed like an act of basic human decency. But to Ruth, this was unexpected and extravagant kindness. Her response, she bowed down on the ground in gratitude and asked, "Hey, why are you being so kind to me?" In Boaz's answer to her, we see his second act of kindness to her, words of blessing. Boaz replied, "I've been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, how you left your father and mother and your homeland and came to live with a people you did not know before. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. May I continue to find favor in your eyes, my Lord," she said. "You have put me at ease by speaking kindly to your servant, though I do not have the standing of one of your servants." So in response to Ruth's question, "Why are you doing this?" Boaz offers the answer, "Well, it's the right thing to do. You, Ruth, are a valiant and upright woman, and not only do I want God to bless you, but I want my own actions to be a part of how God blesses you." He is aligning himself and his resources with God's mission, just as we seek to do week after week when we offer ourselves to God and his purposes in the world. Now, this really gets Ruth's attention. She has come out to work on this day, not knowing what to expect, perhaps expecting for people to treat her badly because she's a foreigner, she's a woman, she's an enemy of Israel. At best, Ruth is hoping to just be ignored and to be allowed to go about her business quietly. But Boaz blows her expectations out of the water. Boaz doesn't look at her and see foreigner, stranger, different, inferior. Instead, Boaz looks at Ruth and he sees child of God. Let us, friends, take note and let us do likewise. Just think, how might our world be different? How might God be exalted through us if instead of allowing and perpetuating stereotypes and labels like lazy or undeserving or different or alien or foreigner or outsider or criminal, if the people of God looked at others who are different from us on the outside and the first thing that came to our minds was child of God, made in the image of God, possessing dignity and worth and value beyond our imagination. Just think of how we could cause a ripple effect of joy by taking time to see others, not the way our culture sees them, but the way that God sees them. And this is part of why Boaz treats Ruth with kindness. That's one answer. That's the answer he gives to Ruth's question, "Why are you doing this?" Basically, it's the right thing to do. It's justice. But I think there are a couple other reasons that Boaz doesn't mention for his kindness. The second reason is that because Boaz is a relative of Naomi's, he knows that he has a certain legal and social responsibility to look out for Naomi and Ruth. As a near relative, Boaz is a goel, a guardian redeemer, or a kinsman redeemer. Basically, in those days, if a person found themselves to be in a particular hardship, it was the responsibility of this near relative, this guardian redeemer, to look out for them, to step in, to intervene, to help them. And so we'll look more at this concept of the goel another week when we get farther into the story. But for now, suffice it to say that Boaz is aware of Naomi and Ruth's situation, and they're on his radar. He knows that as a family member, it's his job to help them out however he can, and he wants to do his part quietly, modestly, and discreetly to help them out. But I think there's also a third reason for Boaz's kindness to Ruth. And that brings us back to the topic of Boaz's family. Now, we already talked about how Boaz was a direct descendant of this man, Nahshon, who was an influential leader of the whole tribe of Judah in the days of Moses. But there's another ancestor of Boaz who is more well-known to us. In fact, we had a sermon back in the month of March talking about this ancestor, and that is Rahab the prostitute. We may not realize this, but Rahab the prostitute is, well, based on the genealogies, she may even be Boaz's mother, but at the very least, she's his grandmother or great-grandmother. And I say this because the genealogies in the Bible don't always include every generation, so sometimes we have to fill in those gaps. But Boaz knows his family history. He knows that he is a descendant of Rahab. He probably knew her firsthand in his own life. And he knows that no one is outside the scope of God's grace. He knows that God is always reaching out to include those in his family that we might think are unincludable in God's story. And so that's one of the amazing pictures of grace that we see in the life of Rahab. As we saw back in March, her life is a powerful rescue story, and one of the beautiful parts of her story is the fact that she, a lady with a Canaanite pagan prostitute background, ends up marrying into the family of Nahshon, one of these influential leaders. She marries a guy named Salmon, who is either Nahshon's son or grandson. And so this is this amazing bringing together of this leading family with ties to the high priest of Israel, marrying into this woman who comes to faith in this God of Israel. And together they form a new life and a new family line. And that family line leads us to Boaz. So Boaz looks at himself, and he knows his own family history, and he knows that there's a second chance for anyone. And while Ruth definitely didn't have the same kind of background that Rahab had, in the eyes of people around her in Bethlehem, she also would have been seen as a social outcast. But Boaz's family story tells him not to write anyone off as a foreigner or an outsider. His actions to Ruth are his way of saying, hey, even though to the world around us, you and I look very different, in God's eyes, we are the same. We are cut from the same cloth. We are both part of God's story of second chances. So with that perspective in mind, we come to Boaz's third act of kindness, which is giving Ruth inclusion and food. In verse 14, he invites her to eat with him and his workers, and he gives her more food than she can even eat at the time. We read, at mealtime, Boaz said to her, come over here, have some bread and dip it in the wine vinegar. That doesn't sound particularly appetizing right now, wine vinegar, but apparently that was something that they got excited about in those days. So we read, when she sat down with the harvesters, he offered her some roasted grain. She ate all she wanted and had some left over. And then on top of all this, Boaz then goes on to perform a fourth act of kindness by pouring out even more gratuitous generosity to Ruth. Verse 15 and the following. As she got up to glean, Boaz gave orders to his men. Let her gather among the sheaves and don't reprimand her. Even pull out some stalks for her from the bundles and leave them for her to pick up. And don't rebuke her. So Ruth gleaned in the field until evening. Then she threshed the barley that she had gathered, and it amounted to about an ephah. Now that's not a unit of measurement that we're familiar with, but that would have been somewhere between 30 and 40 pounds. That's a lot of grain. That is a solid day's work. Verse 18, she carried it back to town, and her mother-in-law saw how much she had gathered. Ruth also brought out and gave her what she had left over after she had eaten enough. So she brought Naomi her leftover lunch, and Naomi got to eat that as well. So this is an amazing first day in Bethlehem. Boaz has officially blessed Ruth's socks off. with the kindness that he has shown to her. She left home that morning, hoping maybe to gather enough food to scrape by for a couple days, but instead she returns with 30 to 40 pounds of grain. Even more, she returns with a new sense of hope and excitement. Her first day jitters have been replaced with a profound sense of relief and a sense of exuberance that God is preparing the way for her. Before we move on, let's pause here for a moment, church, and let's consider the impact of Boaz's actions. In the end, Boaz didn't really do all that much here. He simply paid attention to the needs of a newcomer. He made a space for her in his world. He spoke kindly to her, and he shared part of his excess with her. He had plenty. He didn't give sacrificially. He gave what he could easily afford to give. But to Ruth, these small things were life-changing. So let us consider, church, the power that we have to bring joy to our city in the same way. Let us imagine the joy that we can bring to others through simple but intentional acts of kindness. How can you bring hope to someone that you know by simply taking time to notice them and think about their needs? How can you bring joy to someone by making room for them in your life? How can you offer someone assurance that God is there and God is at work simply by offering them some of the excess that God has placed in your hands? We all have access to simple but powerful acts of kindness that we can easily perform if we will just take the time to look out upon our world with open eyes and open hearts. So friends, let us, like Boaz, be attentive to these opportunities to bring joy through kindness. Let us not forget the gospel. Let us not for a moment forget that God's abundant grace and kindness has been extended to us through the cross of Jesus Christ. He has rescued us. He has given us everything. So let us, friends, be eager to show our gratitude to God and to show the same kind of love and kindness to others. These simple acts of kindness offered in service to God can become one of the tools that he uses to offer a glimmer of hope to those who once were hopeless. As we turn to the end of Ruth chapter 2, we see Naomi's heart begin to change as a result of all this. In response to Boaz's kindness and Ruth's success that day, we see Naomi beginning to celebrate this new glimmer of hope in her life. Now, Naomi's been at home all day. We don't know what she's been up to, but probably her mind has been adrift in painful memories of a lost past and in hopeless thoughts of a bland future. But then Ruth comes home, and she sets down this massive bag of grain. She returns with a feast. To Naomi, it seems like Ruth must have won the lottery or robbed the bank or something, because there's no accounting for this abundance that she returns with. Verse 19 and following, her mother-in-law asked her, "Where did you glean today? Where did you work? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." Then Ruth told her mother-in-law about the one at whose place she had been working. "The name of the man I worked with today is Boaz," she said. Now, Ruth doesn't know that Boaz is a relative, but Naomi knows, and instantly this triggers hope in her mind. Verse 20, "The Lord bless him," Naomi said to her daughter-in-law. "He has not stopped showing his kindness to the living and the dead." She added, "That man is our close relative. He is one of our guardian redeemers." Then Ruth, the Moabite, said, "He even said to me, 'Stay with my workers until they finish harvesting all of my grain.'" Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It will be good for you, my daughter, to go with the women who work for him, because in someone else's field you might be harmed." I think it's likely that at this point Naomi's thinking about more than just Ruth's safety. She's beginning to hatch other plans, but all of that comes into play later on down the road. For now, verse 23 gives us the summary of the end of chapter 2. So Ruth stayed close to the women of Boaz to glean until the barley and wheat harvests were finished, and she lived with her mother-in-law. Now, sometimes turning points in our lives can be momentous and dramatic. We know that things have changed decisively. At other times, turning points can be small, modest, and easy to miss. In this case, Naomi's spirit is lifted by a filling meal and by the prospect of a full belly for several weeks to come. But even more than that, we see that in this small moment, she is beginning to turn a corner. Instead of words of bitterness, she speaks words of blessing. There's now hope for the future. She's reminded that as long as Boaz is out there, there is somebody in her corner. Of course, we know that God was really the one in her corner, but for now, it's enough that she sees a pathway to a better future. The wheels in her head begin to turn. Maybe, just maybe, bitterness and emptiness will not have the final word after all. So far in the book of Ruth, God has been working behind the scenes. The reader is aware of God's actions, but the main characters haven't been able to see it yet. But every now and then, both in the story of Ruth and in our own lives, there are moments when God briefly pulls back the curtain and gives us an awareness that he is, in fact, at work, that there is hope for a new day, that he is writing something new and beautiful in the stories of our lives. And that hope is not always easy to hold on to. But when we finally experience a taste of the harvest, like Ruth and Naomi do at the end of Ruth chapter 2, it has the power to rekindle our faith. It reawakens our hope for the future. It prompts us to rejoice in God's goodness. And it also sustains us through the next wave of challenges that will come. So friends, let us hold on to the glimmers of hope that God gives to us. Let us tell and celebrate the stories of God's goodness so that in good times and in bad times, we will hold on to the hope that God is indeed on the move. He has not forgotten us. When we see only lost dreams and closed doors, God is creating a new and better path. When we feel most alone, God is still there and has not forsaken us. As we continue to survey Ruth's story, let us look with renewed hope to our own stories, to how the good and faithful God is already at work, writing those next pages of our story in his great, good, and glorious book of the gospel. He is indeed making all things new. We may not be able to see it yet, but one day we will. For now, let's hold on to that hope and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pause in your presence and we thank you that you are at work in the world and in our lives. Lord, we confess that so often we long to see your plans, but we can't. And because we can't, we so easily give up hope. But Lord, your word reminds us that you are on the move. And so we ask, Father, that you would give us the grace to continue moving forward into the unknown. Help us to follow you. And Lord, help us in response to your grace to extend your love and your kindness to others around us. Let us be your hands and feet. Let us follow you and let us lead others to you. Lord, through us and through our lives, may there truly be a ripple effect of hope and of joy in our families, in our communities, and in our world. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.